Welcome to Unit 9, Lesson 1, where we will start learning about exponents. Let's start by talking about what an exponent is. What you see over here is called a power. The larger number is called the base. This number up here is called the exponent. I like to give a funky definition for what an exponent is, but the real definition is just this first part. An exponent tells you how many times the base is going to appear in a multiplication chain. So when you see something like 3 to the 5th, it means that there's going to be 5 threes being multiplied together. Now, as I said, I like to throw on this little fact that the multiplication chain always features a 1. It's just invisible. You never see the 1 because multiplying by 1 doesn't ever do anything. So let's do some quick examples. First of all, 2 to the 3rd. That means that there are 3 2s being multiplied together. Again, I keep saying there's this sneaky little 1, but because it doesn't really do anything, we don't write it. So 3 2s being multiplied together equals 8, and that is what 2 to the 3rd equals, 8. The next problem says x to the 4th. Now this means 4 x's being multiplied together, but there's nothing you can really do about that to pretty it up, so we just leave it written as x to the 4th. This work here in the middle was unnecessary. We would really just leave it where it started as x to the 4th. Now this next problem is where we get tricky, 7 to the 0 power. Remember how I talked about that sneaky little 1 and the fact that 2 to the 3rd meant that there were 3 2s and that sneaky little 1? Well, when we have 0 7s, we actually need to write that 1 that's in the multiplication chain but always hiding. So there's still that 1 and there's no 7s with it. So really the answer is just 1. This is called the zero property of exponents. It says that anything to the zero power will always equal 1, because you'll see no occurrences of whatever that a is in the multiplication chain, but there's always that sneaky 1 left over. So anything to the zero power will always be 1. Now the next special exponent rule is a little bit more challenging to understand, and this is the negative exponent rule. What makes a negative exponent confusing is the fact that that negative symbol is less computational and more of a message. It's a message that the power you're dealing with is on the wrong side of a fraction. The formal statement of this property tells us that if you have a to the negative n, so anything to a negative exponent, you're supposed to turn it into 1 over that power. This is because what you're really dealing with is a fraction, and this negative exponent tells you to move to the other side of the fraction, or the bottom of the fraction. Same thing with the rule for when the negative exponent's on the bottom. It's a message that it's on the wrong side of the fraction, so it needs to come up to the top. And it ends up looking like this. Out of all the rules we're going to learn in this unit, I think this one's the most confusing in the way it's written, but it's a lot easier to understand when you start seeing examples. So in our first example, number 1, we have 3 to the negative 4th. That negative symbol is always supposed to stick out like a sore thumb. It says we're on the wrong side of a fraction. But this problem doesn't look like a fraction. But there's a really easy way to make it into a fraction, and that's to put a fraction bar on the bottom and remember that there's always a 1 hanging out down here. Whenever I see that negative exponent, I circle it and draw an arrow to the other side of the fraction. And that's telling me that this whole 3 to the 4th is on the wrong side of the fraction. It needs to go to the bottom. Now remember, there was a 1 hanging out on the bottom, but once there's something else with that 1, you don't really need the 1 because it's going to disappear anyway with multiplication. Now you might get confused because the top of the fraction is currently empty, but remember, it's a multiplication chain, so if it ever looks empty, there's still a 1 sitting up there. And we end up getting this expression 1 over 3 fourths. However, we should never leave a constant number to an exponent in the expression because that can be simplified easily, whether you're using a calculator or just doing 3 times 3 times 3 times 3, 4 threes multiplied together, to figure out the simplified form. 3 to the 4th equals 81. So really, this expression simplifies into 1 over 81. Now in number 2, once again we see a negative exponent, which is always a message. I need to move to the other side of the fraction. So this x to the 4th moves up. Once you move it, you've completed the message. So we don't want to say x to the negative 4th moves to the top, because now there'd still be a message that says move it back down. And we'd get confused. We'd get stuck in a loop where we keep putting it up and then down and then up and then down. Once you've moved it to the other side of the fraction, Get rid of that message. It should just say x to the fourth now. Again, there was a 1 up here at the beginning, but once you put something up there, we don't really need that 1 anymore. And you notice now that the denominator's empty, and you may be tempted to put a 1 down here, but remember, dividing by 1 doesn't do anything. So we don't need the fraction at all. We can just leave our answer as x to the fourth. Now you may be looking at this last problem saying, well, we couldn't leave it as 3 to the fourth, but that was because 3 is a constant. X here is a variable. We can't simplify this any further, so the problem's done. Let's keep going with these rules. This next problem says 5 times x to the negative 7th. One thing to understand is that this 5 and x are separated by multiplication. So this negative 7 is only going to the x. It's not affecting the 5. The 5 actually has a tiny little 1 as its exponent, but we don't write that because it's not necessary. So when I see this negative 7, it's telling me that this x to the 7th needs to move down to the other side of the fraction. So I'm going to take this x to the 7th and move it down. Now this 5 needs to stay on the top. So 5 is going to stay up top, and x to the 7th is going to move to the bottom. And there's no more work I can do here, so this problem would be done. Now similarly, in number 4, this negative 5 is just attached to this x. The 3 is separated through multiplication. So the negative symbol tells me that this x to the 5th is on the wrong side of the fraction, so we need to move it up. Nothing told this 2 to move, and nothing told this 3 to move. So they're going to stay on the top and bottom, respectively. But this negative 5 is telling this x to move, so that x is going to move to the top. And again, it's only a variable attached to this exponent, so we can be done with this problem and just say it's 2 times x to the 5th all over 3. We're going to finish this lesson with a couple more examples that use one or more of these properties we just learned. Whenever you approach a big nasty problem like this that has multiple things to do, the expression I always use is chip away. Look for a rule that you can apply, do it, rewrite the problem, and see if there's anything more you can do next. So the first thing I see that sticks out like a sore thumb to me is this 0 exponent. The reason I always look for that first is because it's really easy to take care of. Remember that anything to the 0 becomes 1. And remember, all of these things are attached by multiplication, and 1s disappear in a multiplication chain. So that z to the 0 is just going to disappear, and what we're going to be left with is 5x to the 4th y to the negative 2nd. I think this is a really important step to just rewrite the problem so you don't get confused and try to do too many things at once. Now that I've rewritten the problem, I notice another issue. I see a negative exponent, which I'm always supposed to take care of. So I'm going to draw a fraction in and take this y to the negative 2nd and move it to the other side of the fraction. Rewriting that, that's going to give me 5x to the 4th with a y squared now on the bottom. And we'll just do a little check to make sure we have no issues. I don't see any 0 exponents. The 4 and the 2, the only exponents I see, they're both positive. And I don't see any other simplifying I can do, so this problem's done. 5x to the 4th over y squared. Now finally, number 6. I don't see any zeros, so I'm going to start dealing with the negative exponents. Y has a negative exponent, and so does w. So both of these need to move. This w to the negative 2nd needs to move up, and this y to the negative 5th needs to move down. So I'm going to rewrite the problem. I still have that 8x squared that's going to stay up top, but now I have a w squared up there. And on the bottom, I still have this 12. I now have this y to the 5th that moved down, and I still have this z to the 3rd that'll stay on the bottom. Now there's no more negative exponents, so we've taken care of that. No 0 exponents. But one thing we haven't mentioned yet is these are fractions, and if you ever have a number on both the top and the bottom, you need to look to see if they can be simplified. 8 over 12 is not a reduced fraction. You could actually divide top and bottom both by 4, and that will give us a rewriting of 2 over 3 in terms of the number part. And we're just going to rewrite the variables x squared and w squared on top, and y to the 5th and z to the 3rd on the bottom. Now this is our final answer because there's nothing else I can do. You keep chipping away until you run out of things to do, and then what you're left with is your final answer. This unit deals with problems that have multiplication chains. An exponent just tells you how many times a particular expression appears in that chain. We're going to be learning lots of properties for these problems, and they can be done in any order since multiplication has the commutative property. So you just have to look for what you can do, chip away, rewrite the problem, and keep going until there's nothing left to do. If you came away with anything else, write that down now, otherwise we'll see you in the next lesson.